Hi guys, and welcome to Learn Extra Live. It's Tuesday, it's grade 10, and today is physical science. Tonight's show is brought to you by Liberty, so thanks guys for that. You guys rock. Last week we covered transverse pulses and waves with Tracy, and tonight our topic is longitudinal waves.
Thank you, Indiana. Hello, everyone. I'm so excited. We're actually in Indiana on the floor doing some experiments in a second. And we're very excited looking at longitudinal waves and pulses. And it's such a nice section. So I think tonight's going to be a good one.
Yeah. So, guys, tune in. As you can see, we've changed the studio around a bit. And we are ready to have some super, super fun. There are various ways to get hold of us, guys. Facebook.com/learnextra. Also, chat to us on Twitter at learnextra. And, guys, please make sure that you ask questions that are relevant to the topic. We will be answering your questions in the last 15 minutes of the show. Guys, I also have a Casio calculator to give away today to the best person. Obviously the best person and the best question or comment posted on Facebook. And we will be announcing the winner tomorrow on the page. So, after the break, we will be back with Tracy. We should do it together, Tracy. Welcome back, guys. I think Tracy is all very excited. This is because we're about to do a live experiment and she gets to boss me around for a change.
Wonderful.
So, I know. Without further ado, boss me around, Tracy.
I love doing live experiments, and particularly like this one because this one actually works, unlike most of my others, so it's quite fun. I'm hoping you've seen one of these, huh?
Slinky, definitely.
Slinky spring. This is my funnest thing to do at school, and it's also because it's noisy, let's be honest.
All kids like noise.
So what we're going to do is I'm going to show you transverse and longitudinal waves. Just remind you from last week. So I'm going to give one end to Indiana.
Okay.
And she's going to go stand
here on the other side for me.
And then we're going to go to the floor. And what we're going to do, so you're just going to put it on the floor for me. Thank you. Okay. Now, we sort of showed you a little bit of this last week, but it was a bit dodgy. It wasn't dodgy. It was just hard to see on the screen. So I just want to remind you. Got to hold it still. So excited. Just remind you what a transverse wave was, okay, or pulse. A transverse pulse was when we do just one of those, okay? Remember, it goes up, and then it comes down, and then we can make a nice little wave, and that looks like something you've definitely seen before. So that was last week. This week, we're going to look at a longitudinal wave. Now, first we're going to start with a pulse, because a longitudinal pulse is just a single one. So watch carefully at the way we make the wave. So a longitudinal pulse, all I do is that. Now, I'm hoping what you saw there is instead of going up and down, I've gone backwards, I've gone forwards and gone backwards. And if you watch carefully, and we know this camera has given us such a nice shot, is you can see the parts of the spring go close together and then far apart. Now, sometimes it goes off to the side because I can't always do it completely parallel. But if we do a whole bunch of these together, we get a nice longitudinal wave. Now, this is really nice because the wave, the particles move backwards and forwards in the same direction or parallel to the motion of the wave, which is really nice. So longitudinal, backwards and forwards. So we can do them nice and fast, and then our transverse goes this way. All right, so it's really important that we see the difference. Thank you, Indiana.
It's my job done. Shall I go?
Ooh. Best part of playing with a slinky.
Very fancy.
So, slinky, very important. So where does that get us? Is if we look at a longitudinal wave, okay. Our definition, which is different from a transverse wave, is that the wave particles in the medium, and in this case it was the slinky, move parallel. Okay, so the parallel here is really important, and you can see in the diagram is here, so this represents my slinky, and it's a much better diagram than I could have ever drawn on my own. So that's when they're far apart, then they go close together, then they go far apart, then they go close together, then they go far apart. That's what makes this so special. And it's actually quite nice with the slinky because you can see it nicely when you do this. And in fact, and I'm hoping at some stage some of you have seen slinkies actually walk downstairs, and I'm sure we could find one on YouTube. But even this slinky, I've tried it at my school, doesn't walk down a staircase because our stairs are too wide. But it walks down because it's creating this longitudinal wave because the strings come back close together and then they come far apart and then they go close together, which is actually really nice. But just like our transverse wave, A longitudinal wave has specific properties, okay? And I'm hoping you remember from our longitudinal wave that, sorry, from a transverse wave that we had crests and we have troughs. Now this, we obviously don't have a crest and a trough because it's not moving up and down. Instead, we have parts, so we're just gonna quickly show you them. All right, let's do it in pink. We have parts where they're very close together, like over here. And that part where they're very close together is called a compression. Now that's a nice logical name because the particles are compressed. So that's easy to remember. And sometimes this is also described as, specifically when we're looking at sound and air waves, when air gets compressed, it's a part of high pressure, okay? When they become far apart, when they're far apart like over here, now this one works slightly different. You would think it's got a stretchy name, but it doesn't. It's called a refraction. Okay, rear refraction. It's one of those funny names that you sort of go, they could have thought of an easier one to spell. The compression and the rear refraction relate to your crest and trough of your longitudinal wave, okay? So it relates to that. To make it a little easier to see, because obviously this is a slinky, it's quite easy to see on the springs, I actually have a nice little video animation to show you. Okay, so we're gonna go there and we're gonna look at the particle motion. So I want you to pay attention. Okay, if we watch the yellow ball, because that's really important on it. It goes in one direction and then it goes, and it swings back, okay? Now, looking at my motion, very faintly, you can see there's a black line down the center here, okay? And I don't know if I can actually draw on this. Let's see. I can. Oh, wrong color though. Let me go back and get a decent color, and I want to show you something, okay? Is on here, ooh, or not, it's gone, sorry. It's a black line down here. That's my rest position. On a transverse wave, it was easy to see because it was where it went flat. It's not so easy to see in a longitudinal wave, but we still have that rest position because it's there. And this particle is only moving backwards and forwards and backwards and forwards. So it has a maximum displacement. It can't go on forever. It goes as far as it can to the left and as far as it can to the right and goes through the middle, okay? Watch, it goes, it repeats itself, the energy gets transferred, and then it goes backwards, okay? So it's forwards and backwards. They come close together, it's a rear refraction. That's a compression when they're close together, rear refraction when they're far apart, okay? It's a really nice section for us because you see their particle motion really, really nicely, okay? That's what we're looking for. This is a little over-exaggerated, obviously, but it hopefully makes it a little easier for you. Okay, now this is a nice picture for you to see, because now you see lots. Over here, rear refraction, far apart on this side. Here, compression, close together. Okay, and if we carry on watching it for a little bit, you can see the yellow particles really nicely moving backwards and forwards, backwards and forwards, so it makes it really easy to see. And that, it's nicely labeled for us, that's our compression close together. Hoping you've seen that this is quite important. Rear refraction far apart. Okay, now this doesn't always make it too easy to work on where we find our wavelength from, but this still has a wavelength. This still, I get confused quite easily. Sorry, I lost my train of thought. Okay, let me put this here, and I can't spell either, don't tell anyone. Sorry, we have a wavelength. But now we don't have a crest and we don't have a trough. So now we've got to think to ourselves, okay, hang on, wait. How do I define the wavelength of a longitudinal wave? Let's take out those so they're not in the way. So, all right, because I need to write over this. Oof, this board is a bit sad. Okay, ooh, there we go. Sorry, it's also squeaking like a chalkboard does. Now, we've got to think back. A transverse wave, we could say from the top of a crest to the top of the crest, bottom of a trough, bottom of a trough, wavelength. But the actual definition of wavelength is the distance between two successive or consecutive points in phase. So if I look at my diagram, that would mean for me that if I chose this as my first point in phase, then the start of my next compression over here, that is where my wavelength would be, because these two points represent the start of the compression and they're going to move forward together and then they're going to move backwards together. So this would be my wavelength. It's much harder to find the wavelength in a longitudinal wave when it's drawn like this. Much, much harder. We can do it from the middle of a compression or a refraction, but that's actually quite difficult to see as well, so we tend not to do that. A lot of the time we're not going to expect you to find it. It's going to be given to you in a diagram form and then written in. Because even with my diagram at the top here, it's very difficult to find two parts that are in phase completely. And I would once again maybe take it from the end of this compression to the end of this compression over there. Because then I know these particles are going to do the same things together, and that's what I need to make a wavelength, okay? But, and we're not going to do that today, if we look at the wave equation. Wave equation, just like transverse waves, still valid. Which means longitudinal waves still have period, okay? And I'm hoping you all remember what period means from last week, which is that it's the number of, it's the time taken for one complete wave. So in other words, your period is the time it takes for one of my particles to move backwards and forwards and back to the middle, okay? Or if you were watching it, it would be the time it takes, if I'm counting longitudinal waves, for it to go from a compression to start at me to for the next compression to start, okay? So period is still valid, which means frequency is still valid. Over here, frequency, okay? Frequency, time taken for one, sorry, it's the number of waves per second, okay? Velocity, speed, completely interchangeable. Wavelength in meters, okay? So it's all the same. Then, this, we're not going to do a lot of sound today, but I want to show you something because this is quite important. When we look at waves and we look at longitudinal waves, working with them as a longitudinal wave like I represented earlier is very, very difficult because we can't get anything from it. It's hard to see amplitude because remember amplitude is the maximum displacement from the rest position, and when it's drawn like the sound wave, which is a pressure wave, it's hard to say, well, where was the equilibrium position? But if we relate it back to our longitudinal wave, so we go where there's a compression, it's where crest is, okay? So we represent where the crest is. Where there's a rarefaction, it's the trough. That means this turns into a nice transverse wave like we've always seen, which means I can easily do things like, well, there's my amplitude of my wave, okay? Or there and there, between those two points, is my wavelength, okay? I can find points in phase really easily. It's much easier to calculate period and frequency from something like this. And in fact, when we do sound next week, I'm going to show you that with an oscilloscope, we change this, and when we work with sound, they don't ever work with it in the real world as a longitudinal wave, because it's hard. It always gets changed into a transverse wave, because we can do things with that. Okay, then, and we went on, okay, and you know what? We're ready to do some questions because we're doing sound next week, so I'm ready for next week's lesson, actually. So remember, a pulse, single disturbance, a wave, is a continuous set of pulses. Longitudinal wave goes backwards and forwards compared to a transverse wave, which goes up and down. We've still got a transfer of energy from one place to another. Now, we're going to spend a lot of time on sound next week simply because sound is the best application of a longitudinal wave that we have. There's not too many other places we see a longitudinal wave except when we're playing with a slinky, okay, whereas transverse waves are all over the place, okay? So, yeah, so we can, I'm going to end the lesson there for now, and then we're going to do some questions just now.
Yeah, maybe what we'll do is we'll take a little break. Hey? Okay, guys, what we're going to do is we're going to take a little break. I see lots of you, Kashifa, Zanele, Isaiah, you're all tuning in. I think that's fantastic. Guys, if there's anything that Tracy's going over that you're not understanding, please get those questions in on the page, and that's facebook.com/learnextra. Also, chat to me on Twitter, that's @learnextra. What we're going to do is we're going to take a quick break. Don't you leave those seats, and we'll see you now. Hi guys, and welcome back. I told you that break was going to be quick, right? Exactly. I've got a little challenge for you guys. There is somebody on the page named Isaiah, and he has said on the Facebook page, hey, just tuned in, and how do you define a wave? And I'm not going to ask Tracy that because I think Tracy might just throw something at me. So guys, if any of you do know the answer, please go to Isaiah's comment and please let him know how do you define a wave. And before we go anywhere else, I just want to let you know we do have a challenge question coming up. I know you guys love that. So join us on Facebook.com/learnextra, chat to me on Twitter @learnextra, and without further ado, let's go straight to Tracy. Trace, take it away.
Okay, well, we have got a multiple choice question.
Do we? No. Fantastic.
Well, we are going to get it in a second, but I've got a couple of questions for you guys. I'm very excited. I actually am going to do a little, that challenge question that came from Isaiah is actually quite interesting because
so you wouldn't have thrown something at me?
No, I wouldn't. I'm quite patient at my moments, but I haven't defined wave in general. We've defined what a transverse wave is, and we've defined what a longitudinal wave is, but we actually haven't defined what a wave is, what constitutes making
so
a wave.
So leave them to come up with the answer?
I would be interested to see.
And then Tracy, you can go over your definition just
yes,
now.
Yes, I think I'd be interested to see what they come up with. But we actually do have a nice question coming up, well, on the board, which is quite nice. And this is very similar to ones we did last week. So I know it all sounds the same, and sometimes you're going, well, why do they tell us a longitudinal wave? It's to prepare you for when we get to other stuff, okay? Because what you need to realize is this is your foundation for stuff that you're going to work on later. So they say to you in the example that we have a longitudinal wave. Now, that may or may not be important. So what we're going to do is I'm going to underline it because it might be needed later. And it has a compression to compression distance of 10 meters. And it takes 5 seconds to pass a point. Okay, so now we're going to say to ourselves, well, the first thing they ask is, what is the wavelength? So we remind ourselves that wavelength is the distance between two consecutive points in phase, which really means it would be the distance between two compressions. So we go, hang on, that seems a little simple, but it's not really, because then what we would say is wavelength is equal to 10 meters. Now, guys, please, this is really, really, really important. And I see this all the time when I mark, is you forget, so you get all excited. The question is, what is wavelength? And you write 10 meters in your paper, and you don't understand why you don't get the marks. Because 10 meters means nothing. We also want to know that you understand that you were asked to do wavelength. Okay, that's very important. Then they ask you, what is the speed? Speed. Very important, okay? What is the speed? So now we go, okay, the wave equation was V equals F lambda. Brilliant. I've just worked out lambda. Ooh, they want V. Let's go back to the question. They said it takes 5 seconds to pass a point. 5 seconds is a time. That means they've actually given you period. They've said to you that the period is 5 seconds. It takes in other words, if I'm watching my longitudinal wave, however it is, whether it be sound, my slinky, but the slinky is a very slow wave, and I see that it takes 5 seconds for the compression to come past me. That's what it's saying. Period is 5 seconds, but this equation wants frequency. So we've got to say, oh, hang on, that means I need to work out frequency. So we do frequency is 1/period. I'm hoping you'll scream at me. We remember that from last week. Okay. Not much difference between transverse and longitudinal waves, except for the way that they're actually created. So frequency becomes 1/5, which is 0.2 seconds. Now, please, grade 10s. Most of you, I'm assuming, with your scientific calculators, particularly if they're new ones, have got natural display calculators. So, and in your maths lessons, you've probably been told that you need to keep them in maths display, which means they'll give you an answer as a fraction. You cannot leave your answers as a fraction because the fraction looks like your substitution, okay? And I want the answer. Please don't do that. I moan at my learners all the time about this because I get very frustrated because all it's doing in your calculator is resolving it to the lowest fraction. Please don't do that. So, let's see what we have. I know wavelength, we worked it out earlier, it was 10, and now I know my frequency is 0.2. Maybe I should actually write nicely so you guys can all actually read this. 0.2, my wavelength is 10. And now we go, I'm hoping you can do this in your heads, but it's okay if you can't, use your calculator. And it's 2 meters per second. Okay, it's quite a slow wave. This isn't a very, very fast wave at all. It could be sound, okay? Though at 2 meters per second, it would be very cold, I think. So, you guys ready for another challenge? We've got one that looks very similar.
Well, what we could do is, apparently I've got the producer telling me that we do have a challenge question. So, how's about it? Let's go straight to our challenge question.
Okay, I hope you're all paying attention. They went quite quickly, but it was a nice, nice challenge question. So we're going to leave it with you guys, but I just want to repeat some of the information in case it went a little fast for you, okay? So what the question said to you is that we have a man, okay, and I can actually draw him because it was even a stick man on the question. So we have a man who's standing between two cliffs, and he claps his hands. He claps his hands. He is, cliff one is on this side, and that distance between him and the cliff is 165 meters, okay? And between this cliff and the man, it's 110 meters. We're assuming that sound is going at 330 meters per second, and in fact, you can't do this question unless you know how fast sound is going at. And they asked you that once he's clapped his hands, what is the time difference between him hearing his echoes? Okay, in fact, they said to you, assuming the velocity of sound is 330 meters per second, what will be the time interval between the two loudest echoes? Okay, in other words, the first time he hears his hands come back from both sides. That's a nice question. So there's a couple of things you need to look at, and they gave you four options. They gave you either 0.67 seconds, or B was 0.17 seconds, C was 0.83 seconds, and D was 0.33 seconds. Now, it's a nice multiple choice question because you're going to learn a lot of things doing this, and we are going to go through the answer a little later, but it's just don't guess. Okay, be careful. Do not guess the answer because I know that's what you do with multiple choice. You must work it out because this question, even as a multiple choice, would make a great long question. In fact, I would be very tempted for my learners who are very grateful right now. Don't set their tests. Okay, so while you thinking along the lines of what's happening with the man and clapping his hands, let's look at another quick example. Now this one is a nice example because now we've got to read carefully what they want. They say calculate the frequency, number one, so that's my first question, and number two, the wavelength. So instead of giving you two parts of the question, they put it in the actual question. Of the annoying sound, and I agree it's annoying, made by a mosquito. It's coming into winter, so hopefully there won't be as much of a problem. And it beats its wings at a rate of 600, oops, let me go back, 600 wing beats per second. Then, assuming the speed of sound waves is 344. If any one of you are now thinking, hang on, wait. In the last question, the multiple choice, you told me sound was 330. Now you're telling me it's 344. Hold on to that question till next week. Okay, there's a very good reason why we're doing that, and it's not wrong. Okay, so I haven't got it wrong in this question. We haven't got it wrong in the last question. There's a very good reason for that. Okay, so I'm gonna keep you glued to your seats, and we're gonna deal with that next week, I promise. So, first thing, we need frequency. And we remember frequency is the number of beats per second. Okay, so we look and we go, oh wait, there we go, frequency is 600. It's ridiculously fast. You can't see a mosquito flap its rings. So you've done question one. The first part said, give me frequency. There we go, frequency done. Brilliant, now we're happy. But now it says calculate wavelength. And we've got to go, okay, well, what do I know? Let's think about this. We know frequency, I know speed. 344, and I know, well, I want wavelength. So this wasn't as difficult as it looked, okay? Because we often we get a little confused by the question, and it's not so much that the maths or the science is difficult, it's just that sometimes we get a little freaked out by the English. So don't work through it bit by bit, because now you look at this and you go, well, we have an equation we can use, because we know that velocity is frequency times wavelength. I know that my velocity is 344, frequency is 600, and I want wavelength. Now, this isn't so bad. I'm just getting my answer because I can't remember this off in my head, because I needed a calculator to calculate this. Wavelength, and remember I'm gonna divide both sides by 344, sorry, by 600, because I want wavelength on its own. And it is quite a small wavelength, okay, because it's a very high frequency sound, and what we find is that when we have I'll speak English for you, shall I? When we have a high frequency sound or wave, we have a very small wavelength, okay? This is very important that you get this relationship, okay? Because sound has a relatively constant velocity, so if I'm changing anything to do with the frequency or the wavelength, they must change in relationship with that. And that's the same with the transverse wave. If I keep the velocity constant but I change frequency, wavelength changes with it. And frequency and wavelength are inversely proportional to each other. Okay, so if one goes up, the other goes down. It's as simple as that. And I think, Indy, we're going to go back to you.
Are we? Are we going to break? Shall we?
Shall we? Because we'll answer the multiple choice
question after the break.
But yeah.
Fantastic. Okay, guys, that's what we're going to do. We're going to answer the multiple... What? The multiple?
Multiple choice.
Multiple. See, now you've infected me. Tracy, she's infected me. So, guys, we'll be answering the question as soon as we get back from the break. Don't forget, get chatting on the wall. Get asking people questions. Answer other people's questions. Guys, the page is not just ours, it's also yours, to help each other learn more and learn extra. What we'll do is we'll see you right now after the break. Hi guys, and welcome back to Learn Extra Live. And Nele, I'm waving furiously back at you. And guys, I hope you're having an awesome, awesome lesson so far. What we're gonna do now is we're gonna find out exactly what a wave is. And no, it's not me waving at you guys, it's something else, I think. So, Tracy,
great.
Should we get to it?
Great. You know, Indy, I'm so glad we got asked that question because, like you said, it's a wave.
Yes, it's the wave.
But it's actually quite a good way to look at it because what are we doing when we're waving our hands? We're moving it backwards and forwards. And actually, we're moving it in a regular motion when we wave properly, okay, not when we're doing silly things. We're moving backwards and forwards. And that is actually our definition of a wave in general. It's a regular repetition of a vibration. Okay, now in a transverse wave, that vibration happens to move up and down so that your wave sort of does that. I'm not really sure what that was. In a longitudinal wave, it moves backwards and forwards, so we get our particles, I'm not going to try and draw it, going backwards and forwards, going close together. But if you remember when I was creating the wave, I had a regular repetition of a vibration. Okay, and this is actually really important because when we get to light, we're going to see that the way light is created is by a particle moving, which is actually very interesting. I like, we got lots of fun when we get there. All right, so it's a regular repetitive vibration, but it's got to be regular, otherwise it doesn't create this nice wave shape for us. So I'm hoping that helped. And did anyone get that?
Well, no? I've got quite a few. Do you guys mind if I read out some of the answers? Tracy,
I
do you mind?
I should. It'd okay. be interesting to address some of their misconceptions,
yeah.
actually.
Okay, yeah. Here's Glory said, wave is a regular repetitive motion that arises when the particles of a medium have been disturbed. The medium particles vibrate around a set point, I think, while the wave moves on through the medium.
That is a brilliant.
Yeah.
I think
Gloria actually wrote it herself as well.
I wish my learner, Gloria, well done, because I wish my learners would write like that.
And then a lot of them are saying, like Gift has said, you know, it's a disturbance. Shabalala said a wave is a single disturbance that moves around.
Can we just
the
talk
pulse.
About that one quickly?
Okay.
It's not a bad definition. It's Shabalala, hey?
Yes, but quite a few people have said the same thing.
Single disturbance.
Yeah.
It's not a bad definition, except remember, a pulse is a single disturbance. A wave is a series of pulses, okay? So the word singles the problem there, and you wouldn't get marks for it. Okay, so you've got to tell me it's a series of pulses. That's what makes the wave. It's got to happen more than once for it to be a wave, otherwise it's just a pulse, and then it's not a wave.
Okay, well, congratulations, guys. You guys all know who answered it, and you guys had fantastic, fantastic answers. I think, let me see how many comments. I think we had about 20 comments. It's amazing, right, Tracy?
I'm so glad, because you know what? I know it sounds like a really simple question, but when I look at my learners and I look at the things that they get wrong, it's always the little things. It's always the simple things that you sort of go, oh, I actually know what that is, but sometimes we don't. So learning definitions are very, very, very important. Now, apparently we haven't had much chatter about the challenge question I gave you today, so we're going to go through it quickly before we get to other questions. It was difficult. Okay, so please don't be like, oh, I don't know what to do. But actually, we think about it, okay? I was banking on the fact that some of you would understand what we meant by an echo. Now, granted, some of you might not have ever experienced an echo, but remember, all an echo is when sound bounces off a wall or a canyon wall or off a cave or whatever. And sometimes in your school hall, don't do this without your teacher's permission, is if only one or two of you go into your school hall and you shout really loud, you'll hear it echo back. You'll hear like a fuzzy noise come back to you. Right, that's what I was banking on. Now, what that actually means is for our little man in the middle of these two clips, is the sound he creates when he claps his hands is going to the one wall and coming back to him, and then he'll hear it again, and to the other wall and coming back to him. Now what that means is we need to decide how long it takes from the sound that he makes when he claps his hand to hit the wall and come back. Okay, that's what I'm looking for. So the trick here has to do with the distance, okay? That's where the trick for this one lies. Because what we're gonna do is we're gonna do two calculations. So if this was a long question and you needed to work this out in a test or an exam as a long question, I'm gonna show you exactly how you would work it out. multiple choice question in a test or an exam, you would just scribble this down on the side somewhere and actually work it out, okay? And I tell my learners this all the time, multiple choice is not playing a monkey puzzle or multiple guess or just going, nah, I haven't used B in a while, so let's choose B, which is what some of mine do. And then sometimes teachers get cool and decide to all use the same letter because we can. Really, that's all we do. So let's look at cliff one, okay? So I would write it as, let's change the color so it makes it a bit easier to see, okay? So at cliff one, let's think about what I know. I know the speed, I told you it was 330. Okay, 330. Now the distance is where the problem comes in. So let's, distance would be delta x, that's what how we write it down, and we've got to think, hang on, wait. The sound goes from the man to the cliff to the man again. So how far did the sound actually move? Not 165, it traveled twice that. So it's two times 165, so it actually went 330 meters. Not 165. This was the trick here. So if we remember that this velocity of speed is distance. Now this one we did this a little bit last time with pulses, divided by time, which means my distance, velocity is 330. Distance is also 330. So my time, which I can put as a t, hoping you all can see that, is 1 second. So for the first cliff, distance, time is 1 second. It takes me 1 second to get there and back. We've got to do the same for the second cliff, okay? So for cliff two, we're going to do exactly the same. I'm not going to write velocity down again because we know it's 330, but the distance was 110, but remember it's got to go to the cliff and come back, all right? So it's 2 times 110. So it's 220, but what did we need? We needed time. So we know velocity is distance divided by time. I'm gonna keep that as a T, so we've got 330. 220. So the time in the 330 will change places, okay, because this one's a little more difficult. And what we get is 0,6666 recurring, which we then put as 2 decimal places, 0,67 seconds. So that means it takes 1 second for it to go to cliff one and come back, but it only takes 0,6 seconds to go to cliff two and back. So that means the time difference, which is what they were looking for, is going to be 1 minus 0,67, which is 0,33 seconds. And that on the multiple choice was option D. Okay, that one was very, very difficult. How did they do?
No answers as of yet. So guys, okay. Maybe they should let us know how you did on the question. If there's anything that you didn't understand, please let us know where you've gotten stuck so we can help you and Tracy can go through it. Right, Trace?
Yep.
Fantastic.
I'm ready.
You ready for a break?
She's ready for a break.
No questions. So guys, what I think we are going to do is we're going to take a short break. I'm going to get Tracy a glass of water, maybe myself a glass of water. You go get yourself a cup of tea, and we'll be back with you in 2 seconds. See you now. Mm. Hi guys, and welcome back. I told you it was going to be a short break. Guys, thanks so much for interacting with us on the page. We're loving it. I mean, even Katiwe says that, she said, my textbook says a wave is a periodic, continuous disturbance that consists of a train of pulses. So guys, keep those comments coming in, keep those questions coming in, always wanting to learn more and learn extra. I think what we're going to do is we get straight back to Tracy, and Tracy's going to take us through the rest of the lesson. Okay, take it away, Trace.
Thanks, Indiana. I really like that last definition. It was actually a very good one, Katiwe. Periodic means regular, means that it's always at the same motion. When we talk about something being periodic, it means it happens at the same pace all the time. So that's just a nice fancy word for regular repetitive motion. So it's great. I actually have a little bit of a question that maybe some of the Facebookers can give us an answer to, because I think this is quite an interesting one, and then we'll do another calculation. And I just want you to have a quick think of this. I'm going to give you four options of different medium or media, to be the word for it, where I want to know whether a longitudinal wave like sound, okay, which is the best one we can think of, whether they can travel through these media, okay? So the options are whether it can travel through a liquid, a gas, a solid, or a vacuum. Okay, so out of those four, in fact, what I want to know is which one can't it travel through? Which one can't you hear sound in? So a liquid, a solid, a gas, or a vacuum. Okay, I want you to think about how we make a longitudinal wave. Okay, because that's really the crux of it, of what we need there. Okay, so while we're doing that, I find another question for us, because I think we struggle a little bit more with the calculations more than anything else. So what it says to us is we have a flute, which is a beautiful instrument, producing a musical instrument, musical sound traveling. Now watch here, look what I've done. Maybe I should have a pen, hey? At a speed of 320 meters per second. So now, so far in today's lesson, I have given you three different values for the speed of sound. It's okay, all right, don't worry about it. And then it says that the frequency of this note is 256 hertz. Next week we'll talk about what note that actually is. So for the musos out there, you might actually know, particularly if you use electronic tuner, if you play guitar, one of those sort of instruments, you'll know what these frequencies are. We're not going to worry about that this week. Now it says to us, what is the period of the note? So the first question is, what is the period of the note? Now here we're going back to what we started off right at the beginning. I need to get my calculator because I can't do this in my head. So what is the period? What's the relationship between frequency and period? I'm hoping you all remember. So period is 1 over frequency. So it's 1 over 256. Now remember, the 256 means that we're making 256 waves per second. So each wave takes a very short period of time, and we work it out, and we get a ridiculous value. It's tiny, tiny, tiny. 0.0039 seconds. Very, very, very fast. And yet, this isn't that high in terms of frequencies. As a human, we can hear up to about 20,000 hertz. Okay, thereabouts. So this is quite a small frequency, though at 20,000 hertz, it's going to hurt when you hear that. It's going to hurt lots. Second thing they want is wavelength. So now we've worked at frequency period, now we need wavelength, okay? And we go, well, doesn't this look like something we've been doing all lesson? We've got stuff that, we've got frequency, we've got our velocity, we want wavelength, so we're gonna do the equation. Velocity is frequency times wavelength. We said the velocity was 320. Frequencies 256. We remember that in order to get wavelength on its own, I'm going to divide both sides by 256. And grade 10s, please, 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 please use your calculators. You really don't need to be a hero with this, because otherwise you're not going to get it right. And that's 1.25 meters. So that's quite a long wavelength. Okay, 1.25 meters. That's it's about this much. Okay, so yeah. Now, did anyone come back to you about where we have the wave?
Where
the wave can't be.
No one came back to that. There are a few questions, okay. If you don't mind. Let's have a look. Banele said, would it still be the same if we had two people clapping on those cliffs?
Only if they clapped completely, completely in sync and were in exactly the same place. So that would be the only way they would hear the claps in the different difference, but in the same time difference. But if they... What would happen is if you had two people clapping in the waves at different points, you'd start to hear funny, like, resounding sound. It would start to echo quite funny, but they have to be exactly on cue together, so it'd be difficult. Yeah.
And we've got Kitiwe, which is just, I think, an interesting tidbit. Mm-hmm. Just in case you didn't know, the symbol of the wavelength is the Greek letter for
lambda.
Lambda. Yes.
It's like a little lamb.
Yeah, like a little lamb.
Yes.
Kind of looks like a little lamb too.
Yeah.
Kind of, not really.
Kind of, not really.
You can imagine. You can imagine.
Yes.
Let me see. Okay, so now this one is from Koketsu. Mm-hmm. And she said, question. So now they say, I think this is from the question before.
Yes.
So now they say the difference between the interval time, I think. Mm-hmm. So where did Tracy get the one from which she minused 0.67 to it?
All right. So if we go back to the question, when the first, from cliff one, all right, it was 1 second. So it took 1 second to travel this distance. Okay, there was cliff one's on the left. And then when I worked out cliff two, okay, it was a shorter distance. So it takes only 0.67 seconds to travel this distance, okay, which means he's going to clap once, this wave is going to go to that cliff two and back in 0.67 seconds, and then he's going to have a lag of 0.33, because the difference between those is 0.33 before he hears the wave from the cliff one. Okay, so that's why I had to minus them, because the question was, what is the time difference between hearing the two loudest echoes? All right, so you've got to consider that this is a shorter distance, it's going to get there and back faster. Okay.
Fantastic.
So I'm hoping that gets it.
Yep. Okay, I do have an answer for your little question.
Brilliant.
Can I give out the answer?
Please do.
If it is right, I don't know. Okay, this one's from De Lorenzo, and his answer is to where you can't hear sound, and he said you can't hear sound in a vacuum.
Brilliant.
Right.
I'm hoping he knows why. Now, I gave that very, very specifically, and every longitudinal wave needs a medium. Okay, if we go back, right back to the beginning, okay? So when I showed you a nice little animation, that's a good one, we'll stick there. We always have to have particles. Longitudinal wave has to have these little particles, because in order for it to move, the particles have to transfer their energy to another particle, and that's how it moves backwards and forwards. In a transverse wave, the particles aren't transferring it from contact almost, they're just going up and down. And in fact, light and the electromagnetic spectrum, which we're going to get to in 2 weeks, and I'm very excited, I love that section, doesn't need a medium at all, which we're grateful for, because we wouldn't have any light during the day because the sunlight wouldn't get to us. But this is where some of our science sci-fi movies get it wrong. Because you know when you watch a sci-fi movie, and I'm a particular fan, is you watch and you hear those big explosions in space, or you hear the lasers going off. You know, you wouldn't actually hear anything in space, because it's a vacuum. There's nothing there. So it needs to have a particle. One of the interesting experiments, which most schools can't actually do, because we don't have strong enough vacuum pumps, is if you could ring a bell, like a school bell, in a what we call a bell jar, inside a jar, and then suck all the air out of it, the bell would keep moving, but you wouldn't hear it. It would be completely and utter silence, because there's no particles to move from one part to the other. And I'm glad you didn't say a solid or a liquid, which I think I was expecting a little, because how many of you try and talk to each other underwater and go, that doesn't sound right?
Well, we actually had a question from Karabo, and Karabo asked, can we hear sound in water?
Of course you can. It just doesn't sound normal. And we're going to talk about that next week, because it's the way our ears are done. So.
Okay, fantastic. Apparently, we are nearly finished with the show, so I think I can squeeze in one tiny little quick question. Okay, this one's from Toomey, and Toomey says, a person sings the musical note middle C, which has a frequency of 256 hertz. How many times does the person's vocal cords vibrate each second?
That's 256 times.
That's amazing. Well, there you go. There you go, Toomey. You kind of answered your own question.
Frequency.
Pretty much. Yeah. Pretty much. Okay, guys, can you believe it? Grade 10s, we've come to the end of the show. Liberty, thank you so much for such an amazing show and allowing us to have such fun as we do, learning more, learning extra. Grade 11s, don't forget, you are up next. It is your time. It is your turn. Grade 10s, unfortunately, for now, it's goodbye from me and Tracy. Bye.